You may be seated. Good afternoon and welcome to the Celebration of Life service for Jane Annette Tarks. I'm Pastor Dan Walters, the pastor here at Good Shepherd. I know on behalf of the family, so thankful to have you all here today. I just wanted to mention, as we're getting started, calling the service a celebration of life, maybe something that many are familiar with, and maybe we often think of that as it's nicer to call it a celebration of life because it sounds happier than the word funeral often, and it makes us think about how we remember her life and not just her death, and that's very true. But I want to just also mention that another, maybe even the main part of celebration of life is to not only think about, yes, her life that she had in this world, but to also look at the present and future life that our God has given her. The eternal life that our Savior has won for Jane is really also what we're here to celebrate today, to celebrate God giving his child the life that his one and only son, one for her, and really one for all people. And so that's what we'll be doing with our service today. One thing that's in the back of your service folder, it's where you find Jane's picture at the back there, I believe. And it's written kind of like an obituary, but this is a little bit expanded from what was in the announcement. And just before we kind of officially get started, I was just going to read those words as we get going here. So Jane Annette Tarks. Jane passed away peacefully, surrounded by her loving family, on October 18th, 2024. While in the hospital, Jane was diagnosed with cancer. After a short time battling with treatment, it was soon found that her body could no longer tolerate the fight. Even though she declined quickly, her faith remained evident the entire time at the hospital. She used her time there to witness her faith to everyone she came in contact with. This is God's plan, and I trust it. Her life was defined by her strong faith. She served beside David for many years at Good Shepherd Evangelical Lutheran Church in Burnsville, Minnesota. Jane was always the go-to person for so many things prior to their retirement. She showed her love for Jesus as the church secretary, helping with Good Shepherd Lutheran School, Pioneers, Sunday school singing, or any program that included the children. Jane always had an ear to listen or a hug to give at any time. Her grace and endless love always showed through every task of her faithful service. Her family was of the utmost importance. David and Jane grew up just houses apart on the same street in Milwaukee. David was the love of her life for 54 years. Their marriage was blessed with children and their spouses, grandchildren and great-grandchildren, all of whom were inspired by the faith and trust she had in her loving Savior. And then the verse from Isaiah 12, "Surely God is my salvation. I will trust and not be afraid." And so with that in mind, we will begin with our opening hymn, Beautiful Savior. Just a note on the hymns, the printed worship folder does have the hymn printed out for you. You could find it if need be in the blue hymnal also, but they should be printed out for you there, especially the specific stanzas we'll sing of each hymn. So we'll join in singing Beautiful Savior.
Thank you.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. As we gather here today, we reflect on why we are here. We have come to pay respects and offer our sympathy to loved ones, and many of us have come to celebrate the life of a person we knew well. Some of us have come to be comforted by God's words to us in this time of grief, and some have come with lingering questions about death and what happens after death. Let us ask God to help us with all our concerns as only He can. We pray. Dear God, You are the creator and sustainer of all life. You want us to know who You are. Open our ears to hear what You tell us in Your word. Open our hearts to understand Your love to us all at this time. Amen. And we sing the hymn verse. We're looking at a part of our service where we're thinking about taking comfort in a time of grief. And to start with this, we're looking at one of God's psalms in His Word, Psalm 31, and looking at the words there that remind us a lot of words like taking refuge or finding safety in our God. That's what Jane did, and that's what God invites us to do. We also hear in this psalm a very famous verse that Jesus spoke. Jesus spoke these words on the cross right before He died, and I'll read those ahead of time. That's, "Into Your hands I commit my spirit." Remember, Jesus said that before he breathed His last and died for the sins of the world. But it's that confidence that He had in saying those words, "Into Your hands I commit my spirit," is the confidence that God's people of faith have in trusting their life and death into God's hands. We read the selected words from Psalm 31. "In You, O Lord, I have taken refuge. Deliver me in Your righteousness. Be my rock of refuge, a strong fortress to save me. Into Your hands I commit my spirit. Redeem me, O Lord, the God of truth. My times are in Your hands. Save me in Your unfailing love. How great is Your goodness, which You have stored up for those who fear You. You heard my cry for mercy when I called to You for help." This is God's word. We'll join then in the first song of Isaiah. Thank you. God speaks to us again with words of comfort from the New Testament letter to the Ephesians, chapter 3. And a lot of this lesson is really a prayer that the Apostle Paul wrote asking that God would bless the people he was writing to. It's also our prayer today for all of us here that, again, we would rejoice in our Savior's power, even his power over death, that he exercises powerfully to his people. So we read here from Ephesians chapter 3. For this reason I kneel before the Father, from whom every family in heaven and on earth derives its name. I pray that out of his glorious riches he may strengthen you with power through his Spirit in your inner being, so that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith. And I pray that you, being rooted and established in love, may have power together with all the Lord's holy people, to grasp how wide and long and high and deep is the love of Christ, and to know this love that surpasses knowledge, that you may be filled to the measure of all the fullness of God. Now to him who is able to do immeasurably more than all we ask or imagine, according to his power that is at work within us, to him be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus, throughout all generations, forever and ever. Amen. And this is God's word. We also hear our God speak to us from the gospel according to John chapter 5. And one of the beautiful parts of the comfort that Jesus is giving us to his disciples here is the same comfort we look to. Jesus says, he, the Son, gives life. He said, the Father gives life, and the Son gives life also. He gives life to his people, his believers, as he has given his eternal life to Jane. We read the words from John chapter 5. Jesus gave them this answer. Very truly I tell you, the Son can do nothing by himself. He can do only what he sees his Father doing. Because whatever the Father does, the Son also does. For the Father loves the Son and shows him all he does. Yes, and he will show him even greater works than these, so that you will be amazed. For just as the Father raises the dead and gives them life, even so the Son gives life to whom he is pleased to give it. Moreover, the Father judges no one, but has entrusted all judgment to the Son, that all may honor the Son just as they honor the Father. Whoever does not honor the Son does not honor the Father who sent him. Very truly I tell you, whoever hears my word and believes him who sent me has eternal life and will not be judged, but has crossed over from death to life. Very truly I tell you, a time is coming and has now come when the dead will hear the voice of the Son of God, and those who hear will live. For as the Father has life in himself, so he has granted the Son also to have life in himself. And he has given him authority to judge because he is the Son of Man. This is God's word. And then also we have another couple verses from the Gospel of John, this time chapter 10, which is the Good Shepherd chapter of the Bible. Good Shepherd is this picture that Jesus painted of himself, of not just the name of our church here, but has this beautiful picture of the shepherd taking care of his sheep. And we're told here that the shepherd knows his sheep and that the sheep know him. And so it's a reminder for us that Jesus knows Jane and Jane knows him. And he gives her eternal life. We read here from John chapter 10. My sheep, this is Jesus speaking, my sheep listen to my voice. I know them and they follow me. I give them eternal life and they shall never perish. No one will snatch them out of my hand. This is God's word. This time we're going to continue with some more verses of hymns in kind of a hymn sing. And you've proven yourself already. This is a good singing group here. And so we're going to make use of you here as a hymn sing that's something that the Jane and the Tarks family found really important and a special idea. So there's a few hymns together. So again, we'll kind of go from one to the other as they're printed there. I know at one point I believe the accompanist is going to switch from the organ to the piano, so there might be just a second as you know that switch happens, but don't worry. We'll get on to the next one. So we'll continue with the hymns as they're printed in your worship folder and on the screen.
Thank you.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen. Dear family and friends of Jane Tarks, but especially Pastor Dave and their kids and their grandchildren and great-grandchildren, the kids' spouses. One of the things that we think about a lot today is the family connections that Jane had and that were so important to her. Again, I mentioned Pastor Dave and how together for 54 years of marriage, how they had five children with the three girls and two boys and their spouses, and then I have this written down, 13 grandchildren, four great-grandchildren. What a blessing, right, that God had given her with her family. And that's not to mention the extended families. I heard with, you know, both the Tark side of the family and the Namundsen side, expecting quite a few people coming today to support all of you in this special time and to be with you during this time. And again, what a blessing and how much God had blessed Jane with her family. Then, of course, there's the connections of her church family. Now, maybe some people, you know, if you're not familiar with churches, although most people here are very familiar, but people might think, well, church family sounds like something that you'd have to say almost with quotation marks, church family, because we know people at church aren't necessarily related to each other, but boy, that's a very real connection that God made as, you know, these fellow children of God, brothers and sisters in Christ, as we often say, come together, and again, what a blessing Jane was to her church family. You know, besides being married to the pastor, of course, at a place where he was a pastor for 40 years, but on top of that, serving as a secretary, the church secretary, for very many of those years, again, the connections that she made with people. I know today we use, you know, computer programs and many databases to keep track of everything that goes on in a church, and you know, we need that. I'm told, and maybe it's slightly jokingly, but maybe not so jokingly, that they didn't really need the computer stuff back in those days because they had Jane. She knew the connections. Not just the knowledge, the head knowledge of who was connected to who, but again, she was there as a friend, and not just a friendly face, but a friend in faith to so many people who would come in the door of church, whether it's this church building or the other one, right? And again, what a blessing to so many, have her connected to so much family of her relative, by blood family, but also the family of faith that God had blessed her with and that God blessed this family with her. But thinking about all this today, we also get this special chance, you know, in a service like this to not only think about Jane's connections to her family and friends, but also Jane's, and especially Jane's connection to her God. And that's what we get to think about for a moment here as we're going to look at a text in just a second. But thinking of that connection, we realize it's also a family connection, right? Because God made Jane his child way back when she was baptized. In the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit, God made Jane his child by faith. And he gave that faith to her, and he kept that faith strong in her throughout her life. And that's one of the things that we're going to think of as we look at this passage today, a passage that very important to the family. It's very similar also to what we've seen. We actually see it on the cover here, but it's from Psalm 56, verse 11. And it's this passage, in God I trust, I will not be afraid. What can man do to me? Very similar to that first song of Isaiah that we sang. Again, thinking of trusting in God and because of that, not being afraid. I noticed when we were preparing the bulletin, you know, we have the Bible passages are kind of built into the software nowadays. So, you know, you can kind of type in a verse and then it'll spit it out for you. And this verse, you know, I have it here in the version that's on the cover of the worship folder, but I found it as interesting. I think in the most recent translation of the Bible, it's slightly different. And at first I thought it was a little maybe awkward and not as easy to read. But then as I was thinking about it, it kind of helped me think about what we get to talk about with Jane today. And so that other wording, which is almost identical, but it's this: in God I trust and am not afraid. What can man do to me? Again, like I said, it's almost identical. You might not have even noticed the difference. And the meaning, of course, is exactly the same. But it helped me think of it because it reminded me that the two phrases, in God I trust, and the not being afraid, they're not really meant to be separate things necessarily. It's not that you trust in God and then someone just sort of hoping, I'll try not to be afraid and I'll work up the courage within myself to not be afraid. No, they're very much connected. And it kind of helped me to think of it and almost combine it this way and think of the two phrases, in God I trust and in God I am not afraid. Reminding us that, again, God is at the center of these things. And this is what he gave as a gift throughout her life to Jane, this trust and this lack of fear, despite what was going on. So I want us to think about this, but thinking of in God I trust with Jane, we might think, first of all, to some of the things we read in those opening paragraphs about Jane's life, how even when she was in the hospital and, again, sick and in her last days, how she would openly say, this is God's plan, and I trust it, and I trust him, right? How she witnessed to that. We naturally think of those things, but I also want to go farther back and how she trusted God in the past. And I don't even mean in the past in her life, although that's very true. Think of what she trusted in God in the past of this world, right? Jane trusted that God knew this was a world that had turned against him in sin, had rebelled against him. But Jane also knew and trusted that God didn't let us die in our sin and therefore die forever. Instead, Jane trusted that God sent his one and only son. And she knew exactly what Jesus did. Even though she wasn't there to see it, she trusted it because God gave her that faith that Jesus came into this world and never made a single mistake, no sin whatsoever, obeyed God 100%, but not to show off and not to gain something for himself. He did that to be the perfection that God demanded of all of us, but for which we've fallen short. And then that same God, and Jane trusted this, had Jesus suffer and die, not for a single crime of his own, but for the sins of the whole world, for your sins, for mine, for Jane's. And Jesus paid the full price. And Jane trusted that. And Jane trusted that as Jesus rose from the dead, showed his power over the grave, how he ascended into heaven, and how he promised, because I live, you will live. Jane trusted that. What a blessing. What a gift to be given that faith. And it's also very much a part, when you trust that, when God has given you the gift to trust that, suddenly these last words don't seem as impossible. In God, I am not afraid. Now, maybe when you think of that with Jane, first of all, you think, well, Jane wouldn't get afraid. Come on, this is Jane we're talking about. She wouldn't be afraid. Because sometimes we sort of think of people that way, where we think, you know, there's certain people, you know, and sometimes people think this way of pastors, and again, someone like Jane, I think, is one of those where someone will think, well, someone like Jane wouldn't be afraid. We're all people, though, right? We're all people with the same, you know, frailties, and for example, I don't think Jane particularly wanted to be sick. I don't think she wanted that in any way. I think, again, if it was all up to her, which, of course, we know that's not how it works, even though she knows heaven is the best place and there's no better place for her to be, she might have thought, I could have gone there a little later. Maybe I could have some more time with my family. Again, if she was, you know, writing the script, or if we were writing the script, we might want it that way. It'd be natural to have, if not fears, frustrations, maybe, at the way things go. I remember talking to Jane, this was before she went into the hospital. This is back early September. And she had had, I believe, some issues with her heart, and she had kind of been gone to the hospital, but then she was back home, but she hadn't been able to make it to church. And so I was talking to her, and if you can believe this, she was concerned that people at church might be concerned with where she was. And if you can believe it, she was thinking of other people and how they might have felt about her not being there. And so she wanted to give the message to me so I could assure them that she was okay, and that she would be back. But again, she was talking about, again, how she had had this heart issue, and because of that, they had taken her off a lot of medications, and they had to slowly put her back on the medications. And it's one of those things where, you know, medications are a wonderful blessing, but also, you know, they can make you not feel right. And so she's being put back on the medications, and it's just, you know, are they not in the right balance yet? Does it take a while for the body to get used to them? And again, she wasn't feeling right. And I can imagine, although I don't think she said this, but I can imagine being frustrated. You know, you just want to feel better. You want to feel good. You want this to live your life, right? But then she said, again, something along the lines of, I trust that God knows what he's doing. I'm here with him, and he's gonna keep his promises. And again, she very clearly was saying those things. Now, there's, I suppose, an outside observer who doesn't know Jane and maybe isn't even familiar with what we're talking about at church with the bigger picture of eternal life. Someone might say, boy, was Jane's trust in God, was it misplaced? Or was her lack of fear? Someone, again, from the outside might say, was it a foolish lack of fear? Because again, from the outside, someone could say, yeah, but she felt that way, but she didn't get better. And we saw how, you know, so fast. And she was sick, and then just before anyone was ready, you know, she was gone. And that's hard. And again, there's times where we can get frustrated, and where we can be, if not afraid, we just say, well, yeah, but why now? But then we remember, was Jane's trust misplaced? Absolutely not. Because God did keep his promise. Did she have anything to be afraid of? Absolutely not, because God was with her. Right? Because we see in God, in Jane's God, in our God, who brought life and immortality to light through the gospel, in him, fear goes to die. And in him, in our God, in Jane's God, even death itself goes to die. And doubt goes to die. But also in that God of ours and in Jane's God, his children go to live. And that's what Jane has received. Right? Her trust was not misplaced. It was in the right place. She had no reason to fear. God has taken that fear away. Just like the passages say that in him there is no darkness at all. Whoever believes in him will live even though they die. And whoever lives by believing in him will never die. In God, I trust. In God, I am not afraid. Amen. And we'll continue at this time by confessing our faith in the triune God, confessing the faith that Jane confessed, by speaking together the words of the Apostles' Creed. So I invite you to say these words along with me. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From there he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. And we continue with the response of prayer as printed and as on the screen. Lord God, Heavenly Father, you are always with us, especially when our hearts are heavy with grief.
Send us your Spirit so that even as we grieve, we are filled with hope.
You have convinced us that your Son Jesus died and rose again, and so we believe that our loved ones who have fallen asleep in Christ are resting in peace with you. What great mercy you have shown us. Through your Son's resurrection, our hope is alive and our inheritance is certain.
Lift us in security, people of joy in your presence. Our blessings that will never perish, soil or grain. Shield us with your power and give us faith to trust in you in every trial until we inherit the glorious riches you are keeping for us.
Gracious God, we see your abiding love in the kindness shown to us by family and friends. As we receive comfort and encouragement from others, we are experiencing your care. We pray this all in Jesus' name, who taught us to pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. The Tarks family wants to call attention to something that's been up here, or it's down here. And that's, there's a picture of Jane up here, of course, but there's also this picture of Jesus. Maybe you saw it sitting here, but that was put there on purpose. So this is a picture that's special meeting and had become a major conversation focus for Pastor and Jane in recent months. This picture had been purchased 20-plus years ago by Pastor and Jane. It's at the Northwestern Publishing House store that had been in Milwaukee during a Christmas getaway from their home in Burnsville. When Pastor and Jane moved to their son's home then in Inver Grove Heights, the picture caught their attention again. It had maybe been in storage or they hadn't been up, and then they saw it again. And it caught their attention and was placed in a prominent place in their family room. And it's their prayer to have that up here today, that it serves to underscore the importance of our relationship of being in Christ Jesus, our Lord. May our Lord Jesus be praised for all he has done, is doing, and continues to do for the grace and glory of God. And so with that, there is in the section marked celebration, as again, we celebrate the life, not only that Jane lived in this world, but the life God has given her now. There's a section that's a bit of a responsive reading. And what it was is a devotion written by a pastor named Pastor Darren Lindemann. But it's just a short way to have this truth of what it means to be in Christ Jesus our Lord imprinted on us. So we'll speak these words together. I invite you to speak the bold parts, and I'll speak the other parts. And then we'll speak together the verse at the end as well. In Christ Jesus our Lord, death is dead. It cannot kill. In Christ Jesus our Lord, life is bigger than your surrounding circumstances. You are not defined by what happens to you. In Christ Jesus our Lord, angels clash with demons in spiritual warfare to protect you, and angels always win. In Christ Jesus our Lord, today is a gift. That's why we call it the present. In Christ Jesus our Lord, the future isn't something to worry about. Nothing that happens to you tomorrow or next year beats him to the scene. In Christ Jesus our Lord, powers of this world are pawns for his kingdom, and you belong to his kingdom. You are on the winning team. In Christ Jesus our Lord, Your whispered prayers reach higher than high stress, high taxes, high blood pressure, high demands, high risk, and high hopes. In Christ Jesus our Lord, your faith digs deeper into his life-giving water than any depths of despair. In Christ Jesus our Lord, there is nothing that you do, nothing that happens to you, nothing you forget to do, and nothing you neglect that will make him love you any less. For I am convinced that neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither the present nor the future, nor any powers, neither height nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus our Lord. And so it is with that spirit of celebration and God keeping his promise that we hear God speak to us again, but this time from the very last book of the Bible and one of the last chapters of the Bible, where God gave the Apostle John a vision of eternal life, the new heaven and new earth that we think of as heaven, that God has prepared, that our Savior has prepared for his people. So we read from Revelation 21. Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and there was no longer any sea. I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride beautifully dressed for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, "Look, God's dwelling place is now among the people, and he will dwell with them. They will be his people, and God himself will be with them and be their God. He will wipe every tear from their eyes. There will be no more death or mourning or crying or pain, for the old order of things has passed away." He who was seated on the throne said, "I am making everything new." Then he said, "Write this down, for these words are trustworthy and true." And we sing the hymn verse of Jerusalem the Golden. Receive with believing hearts the blessing of our Lord. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look on you with favor and give you peace. Amen. Amen. Now we will have one more song. Before that, I'm going to make a couple of announcements because I believe I'm going to walk out with the family during the song. So I'm going to announce this first. Obviously, on behalf of the family, I thank you so much for being here and for being with them and comforting them and yourselves in this hour. And remember that you are invited to a supper after this in the fellowship hall. And I think they've set some places in other rooms in case we have to overflow. And so we have room for you and food. And by all means, you're welcome to join us for that. I will also say and invite you to join in a meal prayer at this time before that. Whether you're joining us or not, feel free to join in the prayer. Come, Lord Jesus, be our guest, and let these gifts to us be blessed. Oh, give thanks unto the Lord, for he is good, for his mercy endures forever. Amen. And so that we'll close our service then with our final hymn, Go My Children, with my blessing.